Good afternoon, everybody. First,
good afternoon, sir.
It's my pleasure to interact you with the subject. In fact, this is a contemporary subject which Dr. Jyotiram has selected. And I'll be too glad to share my experience working at an international level, as well as visit to the number of countries, interacting with the people. And over a period of time during my presentation, I will try to share some of my experience in this area. May I have the first slide?
Yes, sir.
I can have the first slide now. Can you see it?
No, sir, it is not visible. Have you started screen sharing, sir?
Beg your pardon? In a place called Nanjing, where the conference was organized, international conference was organized, and then subsequently I visited even the Shanghai. I must tell you that yes, it's a regimented kind of a thing, but nevertheless, it has shown the phenomenal development. The pharmaceutical industry in China, at an international level, my experience has been, it does not have that good image. To give you an example, quite a few years back, I think about 8 to 10 years back, there was one import which was referred by Amsterdam. You know, Amsterdam is a place where all the exports which are required to be sent to eastern side of the country or western side of the country, it goes to Amsterdam, and from Amsterdam it gets distributed. The people from the regulatory agency from Amsterdam, they referred the matter to Dr. Reddy's laboratory, because there were containers which were supply of pharmaceutical drugs, which were labeled as a Dr. Reddy's laboratory. And the matter was referred by the regulators to Dr. Reddy's laboratory because the drug was found substandard. When it was referred to Dr. Reddy's laboratory, a person from Reddy's laboratory went to Amsterdam to examine the matter. When he went over there, and then he tried to remove the, in fact, you know, he was surprised because the kind of a drug which was supplied over there, it was never supplied by the Dr. Reddy's laboratory. They removed, in fact, you know, the outer label which was present over there onto the container, and they were shocked to know it had an internal label. Inside, there was a label which was manufactured in China. Dr. Reddy's laboratory took up the matter and they sued the company, and there was a legal fight. Regulatory controls in this country, that is in China, I had opportunity, in fact, you know, because I was with Ranbaxy, and during that time we took over one plant in a place called Guangzhou, and I was advised by the top bosses to send the middle level manager to Guangzhou. I sent over there. I was curious, in fact, you know, and every day I was in contact with him. I asked him, I said one question, that how is the level, I mean, what is the level of GMP which they have? This is the matter which is related, I would say, that during late 1990s. In fact, you know, in those days, the China used to say that we have got our own GMP. That did not follow the international GMP. So I asked my manager, I said, how is the situation? He said, doctor, they are absolutely in infancy. Over a period of time, in fact, you know, they have tightened the requirements, and you will surprise that last year, December, November, when I went over there and I wanted to buy an antacid tablets. When I went to a clinic which was there in the hospital in the hotel itself, I was told by the doctor that you will require a prescription. So I explained to him. I said, "Antacid, it's a general product." He said, "No, in this country we have Titan, and you will have a problem. Don't worry, I will give you a prescription." So he gave me the prescription for antacid tablets. Just to give you an idea with regard to the price, this particular tablet, it was similar to that of Jellucil MPS tablet available in this country. The price of this particular product, a blister of say 10 tablets, it costs 100 rupees. 100 Indian rupees. A similar one, a similar product in India, you will get it around 20 rupees. The bar, in fact, you know, as a part of the conference, they had also organized our visit to a biotech development park. Huge facility which has been created by China. Which has this particular total development is concerned, it has been developed with several European countries' participation. So far as this facility is concerned, they have created one of the class facility with the support of several, I would say, the European countries. So far as the transfer of coronavirus is concerned, it was transferred from Wuhan. There was one professor from Boston and the Harvard. They were paid by Chinese government $50,000 per month to siphon out the technology of this particular particular virus. Let us have a look at, in fact, you know, where do we stand? Indian scenario, what is the Indian scenario? Where do we stand as a profession or as an industry? As of today, in fact, you know, the India is considered as a pharmacy of the world. Just to give you some more idea in support of this, India supplies 70% of the immunization vaccine to the world. President Trump recently had announced that the corona vaccine on which they have been working, it will be manufactured in India with Indian collaborations. Pharmaceutical exports works out to 120 countries in the world. And medical tourism, it's a global opportunity which has opened up because of the development of the pharma industry as well as the pharmaceutical facilities. Exports to US, it works out to 40% of the drugs and drug products from India. India provides 15% of the world export of medicines. Recently, in fact, you know, Dr. Harshvardhan, our health minister, he has been appointed as an executive director, the executive board chairman of the WHO. This was done through a secret ballot of 194 nations. In the world market, in fact, you know, there is a one product manufacturer market, in fact, you know, which has been registered by the company called Gilead. It is a US company. The name of the drug is Remdesivir. And drug was developed for Ebola. However, it has been found that it works even in case of corona. And since the internationally, it is recognized that this is the international, in fact, you know, the issue, the WHO has decided no company will have any monopoly on this drug. And Gilead is concerned, they have contacted three companies in India who will manufacture with no monopoly. let us just have a glance at, you know, their, what was the role of WHO in corona pandemic. As I mentioned, you know, that a coronavirus is concerned, it was supported by two professors, one from, both are from Boston, and they were paid $50,000 per month by China. In fact, that the present WHO top boss, he was with a Middle East country. He was looking after, he was also a health minister over there. And he was supported by China. He was also supported to become a WHO top boss. As a result of it, this gentleman also, he thought that he need to support China. And when the corona issue came up, at the time he visited China to brief them, inform them. And then he came out with a kind of a statement which nobody accepted in the world. It was a shameful kind of a thing by the WHO head. Let us accept it. This is an international disaster. Now, as a pharma industry, how do you have the disaster management? You need to have SOP for the same. It may be considered as a post-disaster management SOP for corona. I had opportunity to have similar situation in India when we had a major earthquake in a place called Gujarat in Ahmedabad, where number of buildings collapsed as well as number of people died. And I was heading, in fact, you know, one of the pharma industry over here. We did not have, in fact, you know, the disaster management SOP at that time. But the first thing I did was we made an SOP on post-disaster management. It is a must. You have to spell out what all things that you are going to cover, what all things which you are going to be examining, what all things which you are going to be controlling, and how are you going to control. That is one excellent, in fact, you know, the guidelines of 7 pages, which has been brought out by Dr. A.J. Wanzil. Dr. Wanzil was a regulatory agency person in South Africa. Later on, he worked for WHO. And I had opportunity, in fact, to be inspected by Dr. Wanzil in number of inspections in different companies. I have gone through these particular guidelines, and the point to consider in the pharmaceutical manufacturing during COVID-19 pandemic. This is a just recent one, that is, it came out in the 12th April 2020. And this covers the quality systems. How will you manage? What all things which you will require in the premises? How will you go about the equipment? People working in the area, personnel protective equipment. How will you handle the materials? How will you deal with the engineering and utilities? The quality department, that is quality control and quality assurance. This has got the references which I have given over here. Even MHRA also has got a guidance on the coronavirus. FICCI and WHO has also prepared a combined COVID guide, which is dated 26/5/2020, just a few days back. And this guideline is also, it's a very exhaustive guideline. What are the international crises and how these crises are created in a situation like this? So far as the new drug or for that purpose, the repurposing of the existing drugs, at an international level, it is a very heavily politicized. It's a money-driven international competition, and it is an international game. I will call it as an international game. To give you an example, you know, hydroxychloroquine manufactured in India, when it was first time found that yes, it can be used, large quantity of the products of HCQ, they were exported to several countries, including France, US, and Europe. France had conducted clinical trial using the 1,000 patients. Out of this 90%, that is a 900 and odd number of patients, they got cured using this drug. Remaining, yes, they had a death to an extent of about 4%. HCQ versus there is another drug, Remdesivir. This is the drug which I told you earlier. It is marketed by Gilead. It has been introduced by the Gilead. And this particular drug, basically not designed for a, it was not designed as a matter of fact for the present situation. ICMR, based on, in fact, you know, the Gilead, in fact, I understand, it's an international scenario, and at an international level, the multinational companies, how do they play their game? I have worked in the multinationals, I have worked also in the international business, and I know what people do and what kind of a game which the multinational companies, they play at an international level to capture the market. The Gilead, in fact, you know, is concerned. They paid US $2,500,000 to dump hydroxychloroquine, to see to it that the hydroxychloroquine, it is condemned. However, in India, in fact, you know, the ICMR did quite a bit of work on this, and they have cleared the drug as a prophylaxis drug. You will surprise further, you know, the controversy does not stop here. One of the finest, I would say, the publication, which is called as the Lancet, it supported the decision of Remdesivir, and this was questioned by more than 100 scientists. Obviously, the Lancet also must have got their own share of US dollar. Corona vaccine, in fact, you know, how the international business scenario changes. The two rivals, which is China as well as the US, both have developed corona vaccine. Both China as well as the US, they are in collaboration. It's nothing else, it's a marriage of convenience. The business is a game. Concept of self-reliance in India, it started way back to 1970 with the introduction of a DPCO. I'm sure Drug Price Control Order Act, all of you must be aware. Under this particular order act, the government had introduced compulsory, in fact, you know, manufacturing of the bulk drug and the formulation. Depending on your turnover, you have to meet the ratio parameters decided by the government. Ratio parameter in the sense that certain percentage of the, if you are manufacturing formulation, then certain percentage of the bulk drug has got to be manufactured by you. Otherwise, it is not acceptable to the government. I had opportunity while in the industry, pharma industry, I had opportunity to face this situation also. In the present scenario, the government incentives are there to industry. The DPCO 1970, let us accept it, people did not like, industry did not like at that time, but it has done a phenomenal, I would say, favor to the pharma industry. Over a period of years, as of today, what we are in the drug and pharma industry in the world, thanks to DPCO, I will not hesitate to say. Yes, I did not like while in those days of 1970s, I did not like government introducing DPCO. But in retrospect, when I look at it, I feel that yes, it was a good decision taken by the government. In the today's scenario, in fact, you know, the government of India is going to provide incentive to the industry. We'll have to provide incentives because unless the financial assistance is given to the industry, the Make in India concept cannot be realized. Make industry self-reliant for a drug intermediates, bulk drug to avoid imports. As of today, large number of drug intermediates, chemical substances, as well as the bulk drug, we do import from China. The objective is very simple, to make India a self-sufficient in this area as well, and give opportunity to the industry to make it export-oriented, and not only export-oriented, but then in that case, as of today, what people say in the world, that India is a pharmacy of the world, to take it further, how best and what best role that India can play in the market of the drug and pharmaceuticals. This will certainly require, as a matter of fact, research in industry as well as academia will have to be reoriented. We cannot be self-sufficient in academia in working on the conventional kind of a dosage form of no value to the industry. I may sound very blunt. I have worked in academia, I have worked in industry, and I do realize that the research activities carried out in academia has no value in industry because it cannot be taken up. Let us accept it as a reality. So far as the research publications from Indian universities are concerned, they are not respected by the Western world universities. The students working over there, I've been interacting with them, and they say that the professors over there, they say, the moment they say that these are the publications from Indian journals, they have a scant respect for it. They have a very serious doubt with regard to the genuinity and the questionable data integrity. That's a reality and which we have to accept. I may share over here the world data on the data integrity. I'm sure all of you are familiar with the world data integrity. That covers, in fact, in a nutshell, it covers, in fact, you know, the data, the questionable data provided by the industry or by the institutions. The highest number of warning letters issued by US FDA was to India, number of industries. The next number comes to China. And you will surprise and shock if I tell you that the third number is US. We need to really look at it. How can we avoid the issues of a data integrity? Drug intermediates are concerned, industry needs support from academia. We need a change in the following area. So far as the drug intermediates are concerned, the bulk drugs and the diagnostics are concerned, we need to strengthen the pharmaceutical chemistry and pharmaceutical engineering knowledge in academia. Fermentation industry and vaccine development is concerned, you will surprise if I tell you, pharmacists are not employed in these industries. For obvious reason, the knowledge of pharmacists of microbiology is concerned, as well as the pharmaceutical engineering is concerned, is not even a peanut. We need, as a matter of fact, pharmaceutical engineering to be revolutionized in terms of its utility. As of today, whatever the course content which we have, it has no utility, in my opinion, so far the industry is concerned. Medical devices, artificial intelligence, these are the area which requires, again, pharmaceutical engineering and IT expertise. The question comes, do we have? Can we meet? Can we provide employability of our pharmacists in this area? We need to have a linkage of regulatory with every subject in pharmaceutical sciences. Because today, the regulatory is concerned, it is considered as a necessary evil in academic institutions. Sorry to say, I may sound very blunt, but this is a reality. I work for the number of universities in this country and also worked as an examiner for a postgraduate doctorate also. Besides, in past, I used to accept even the undergraduate. And the knowledge of regulatory is concerned, it does not work out even a peanut, so far as the students are concerned. It is very important for academic institutions to understand that there is no love for deadwood topics or the subjects. Adaptability to accept the need of the profession and the country, which will give, in fact, you know, the employability to our students. We have got a serious issue with regard to the employability. Let us also accept as a reality, students after B-Pharm or M-Pharm or even a PhD, they find it hard time for them to get into the industry. That's a reality, because I have been interviewing candidates for academic institutions as well as for industry, the various types of work in the industry. What is the international expectation from India? It is expected that India will be the lead country in the world so far as drug pharmaceuticals are concerned. I come to the another aspect, that is, the world has accepted Ayurvedic as well as the herbal products. Last year, I was invited, that is 2018, I was invited by Boston to deliver a lecture there. During the breakfast time, I had one lady, elderly lady, she was from the biomedical specialization. We started talking and I told her that I am from India. She got very much interested in it. And she asked me that, yes, you have got a large number of very useful Ayurvedic. First time I heard word Ayurvedic, you know, from a Western person. And I felt very happy about it. And she said that, yes, you have got a very good product. Since she was an elderly patient, elderly lady, I just asked her, do you believe in it? She said, yes, I think, yes, there are some of the things which are very good. So I told her, I said, for a person like of your age, you require to support, in fact, you know, your total system and the brain. And that support can come from Ayurvedic product. She was shocked. She asked me further. She went into the depth. She wanted me to go into the depth of it, and I told her. I said, "Do you know there is something called as a turmeric which we use in our everyday usage?" She said, "Yes, yes, I know turmeric." I said, "Do you know the black pepper also?" She said, "Yes, it's on our dining table." I said, "Do one thing every day morning when you get up. Boil about 100 ml of water. And to that boiling water, you add 2 pinch of black pepper powder. Mix it up, keep it for about half a minute. Add to that turmeric. Stir it, keep it for another about half a minute or 1 minute. And thereafter, in your empty stomach, you drink this. First thing in the morning. You do it every day and see the results yourself." She asked me that, "Have you tried?" I said, "I've been trying for quite a few years." When I came back from Boston, after 15 days, she spoke to me and told me, "Doc, this really works. There is no doubt about it. This is the, in fact, you know, acceptance by the Western world so far as Ayurvedic is concerned and herbal products are concerned. Brazil has adopted Indian Ayurvedic standards. Can you imagine?" I happen to be, in fact, you know, a member in the Indian Pharmacopoeia Commission way back to 2009. We entered into an agreement with the British Pharmacopoeia as well as the US Pharmacopoeia. We entered into a memorandum of understanding that there will be a mutual exchange and permissibility of the monographs given in the respective pharmacopoeia, which can be adopted by any one of these people. And so was the case with India. USP has accepted, just to give you an idea, anti-HIV drug, first time in the world it appeared in the Indian pharmacopoeia. And you will be surprised if I tell you that USP had requested Indian pharmacopoeia that they wanted to adopt, in fact, you know, the monographs given of the anti-HIV drugs. In any case, we told them that, yes, you have a permission because we have signed that memorandum of understanding. So they adopted that. USP provides it today, you will find, in today's, in fact, even at 2020, it provides a large number of monographs of drugs of, they call it as a drugs of vegetable origin. They don't call it as a herbal, they don't call it as a Ayurvedic. And most of the standards which are appearing there, they are similar to that of Indian pharmacopoeia with the stringent standard for metallic impurities. The question is, can we do it? Our standard is very, very relaxed. Not only that, our herbal as well as the Ayurvedic product. Let me tell you one thing. We have in our country Indian Ayurvedic pharmacopoeia. There are 9 volumes, and which also covers, in fact, you know, the metallic impurities as well as the standard given in therein. They are similar to that of Indian pharmacopoeia. However, I doubt very much whether anybody is really observing that. I'm reminded of an instance. You know, there was one seminar which was organized by USFDA in Mumbai. I was invited, where they wanted to make a presentation with regard to the latest method of analysis of the metallic impurity. They brought the equipment, you know, from US for a demonstration. Phenomenal. All that you require to do is that you just put your drug or product over powder, whatever it is, material which you have, in a cup-like thing. Just cover it up, and that's it, and just put it over there. It will give you a graphical presentation of the impurities which are present in ppm values. The different impurities, metallic impurities. it tempted me that why not? I requested one peon from there that can you go and get one blister of paracetamol tablet, Crocin, and another one, any Ayurvedic product available in the market there, in the shop. The fellow brought this, both the products. Ayurvedic product was first in my mind. So I requested US people that, can you please analyze this also? I was shocked, as a matter of fact, everybody were, they were shocked to see the level of impurities which were present in that Ayurvedic preparation of the several metals, not one, not only the heavy metal or not only the lead. Similarly, I got it examined, even the Crocin tablet. It had a very high concentration of lead. Can you believe? Most of the standards which we have, these are outdated standards, and whatever the USP has adopted the newer method for metallic impurities analysis, the question is, can we do it? Can we upgrade our quality control, quality acceptance, or a quality concept of Ayurvedic as well as the herbal, with special reference to the metallic impurities, standardization, assured repeat therapeutic performance? I have quite a few friends who are postgraduate doctors in specialization in Ayurveda. I was interacting with them and I asked them, I said, can you show me the level of standardization for the active constituent which is present in each one of the constituent, each one of the herbal Ayurvedic product? Next question is, can you assure the repeat therapeutic performance of it? There was shock. There is nothing called repeat performance. There is nothing called therapeutic performance. Let us accept it as a reality. Indian Ayurvedic pharmacopoeia, we have got 9 volumes which exist in the country. And I have got all the volumes. Where do we stand in international market so far as these aspects are concerned? Mind you, this pharmacopoeia also includes the metallic impurities analysis to be carried out in line with the Indian pharmacopoeia. Ministry of Ayush, this is another thing which is really been taken up by Government of India, Ministry of Ayush, ICMR, and they have conducted the clinical trials for potential Ayurvedic drugs which are based on the immunoprotective and antioxidant properties. This has been done in light of the corona issues in the country. To begin with, they have taken up Ayurvedic drug like Tulsi, Ashwagandha, and the third one is a Giloy. Most modern method of the clinical trials have been employed so far as these are concerned, which are used, in fact, you know, for a clinical trial which with the standardization of the active constituents. If proved effective in these clinical trials, it will open a floodgate of Ayurvedic products of international standards. Boost to Ayurveda, centuries-old concept. Let us accept it as a reality. I was with a NMIMS university, and one of my PhD scholar, you know, she came one day and requested me, sir, I want you to suggest me PhD project. I said, okay, give me a day's time. I have got, in fact, you know, the Sushrut Sanhita, Charak Sanhita, as well as the Yajurveda. You will surprise, these are the English translation of the original Sanskrit version. And you will further surprise if I tell you, these books of standards, recognized standards, they were translated into English by one professor in California University with the help of Sanskrit scholar. And I have got all the three books with me as a soft copy. Herbal systems are concerned the use of turmeric. The active constituent is a curcumin, as you know. The black pepper, which contains a piperine. Ashwagandha, you know it pretty well. Number of bioenhancers and the antioxidants are there in the herbal system. I am reminded, in fact, you know, the India, while talking of the Indian as well as the herbal system, Ayurvedic system, one of the universities in Australia, a veterinary doctor had carried out these trials. Indian cow was there. The cow was a cow was pregnant cow. The cow was injected with the HIV. And over a period of about 2 months or so, after 2 months or so, the cow gave a birth to a calf. The milk came out of the cow was tested. And to their surprise, they found to contain immunoprotective activity. So far as the milk is cow milk is concerned. Based on this information, Americans also jumped at it and they tried out because they are very proud of their Jersey cows. And when they carried out the trial with the Jersey cows, to their surprise, they did not find any immunoprotective activity at all in a Jersey cow. In other words, Indian cow has a monopoly so far as the immunogenic activity is concerned in the milk. Here I'm also providing you that how the nature comes to rescue of a human being. These are the list of, in fact, you know, the herbal product, I've given the names of the bioenhancers which are present into the original drug, Ayurvedic or you call it, or herbal you call it. The source I have given and the bioenhancers which are present over there, I have listed out over here. Several of these are being used in US as a immunoprotective. There's another list of it. Many of these, I'm sure, all of you must be aware of. One more thing which I will tell you, in fact, you know, we consider cow urine is concerned. It is considered as a very well respected material. At one point of time, it was also condemned by the US. And we had one prime minister, ex-prime minister of the country, Morarji Desai. He used to drink it every day. And Americans used to joke that Americans take whiskey and Indian prime minister take whiskey. Friends, let us accept these are the realities. Where do we stand? Where we want, in fact, you know, the Indian pharmaceutical industry to be taken to? Help and support of, I will say, academia is very much required so far as the future is concerned. But yes, there is no doubt about it. We have to go a long, long, long way. No doubt about it, the success is knocking your door. Are we prepared to accept that one and work in that direction? It is a question of $1 million. But nevertheless, I am very optimistic, you know. The way the present government, present prime ministers is going ahead with. given a full thrust to him and his ideas as well as in his up to his approach, I'm pretty confident, you know, that India will lead and prove itself that yes, India is the pharmacy of the world. Thank you very much indeed. So nice of you for giving me a patient hearing. Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir. Thank you very much. Literally, it was a fruitful session for us, and we have heard about each and every aspect of pharmaceutical industry as well as academia also. You touched all the aspects, and this session will be fruitful not only for the industrial people, but as well as for academicians also and the students also. And the talk you have given here, this opens a new path for us, definitely, sir. And we will have to rethink upon it that you talked about where we stand at present, and you have talked about the academic situation and the gaps that industry and academia has got at present. So we will have to look at that point also. So definitely, sir, we will see it. And I thank you for this valuable talk. Now, sir, with your permission, I would like to ask some questions that we have got from the participants. So if you permit, sir, shall I ask some questions?
You're most welcome. I'll be too glad, as a matter of fact, you know, to respond.
Thank you. Thank you very much, sir. And meanwhile,
Dr. Satish.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
You first finish with your questions, and I'll also have to ask one question from Dr. Satish.
Sir, you start from your question, sir. After that, I can also continue.
Okay, Dr. Saab, say a question. Pooch sakta hun?
Uh-huh, please.
Namaskar, sir. I am Kishore Purswani, part of the institute.
Yes.
Thank you very much for a very enlightening session and a very encouraging session for showing us that will be the future of the world, the Indian pharmaceutical industry is future of the world. Sir, ek question basic doubt mein aata hai. जब आपने इतनी सारी चीजें बताई टेस्टिंग पे कि एक बड़ा क्वेश्चन मार्क लग जाता है, और इस कोविड एरा में इतने सारे हैंड सैनिटाइजर्स, वेजिटेबल सैनिटाइजर्स और दुनिया भर की चीजें आ गई हैं सर, और दुनिया भर की कंपनी ने इंट्रोड्यूस किए हैं, अचानक एक शॉर्टेज थी, आज मार्केट में बाढ़ है, तो किस पे विश्वास किया जाए, किस पे नहीं विश्वास किया जाए, इसका क्या तरीका है?
वेरी गुड क्वेश्चन. I will tell you, Dr. Saab, let us accept it as a reality. As a hand sanitizer, you need to have a minimum 70% of alcohol.
Right, sir.
Any product which contains 70% or more alcohol, that will be certainly effective against the disinfecting property.
Right, sir.
Number one. Number two, as a matter of fact, Maybe academic institutions can take up even at a postgraduate level the comparative evaluation of the different, you know, the sanitizers available in the country. And the so-called, you know, the liquid soaps. Let me tell you one thing, India is a democratic country. And we do not restrict, as a matter of fact, industry to talk any nonsense. Let me tell you frankly, like in India, even in US also, there were large number of products marketed by the pharma industry people as a liquid soap, claiming anything and everything under the sky that it can take care of. US FDA commissioner, I must hats off to that lady, I forget her name. She really questioned that, okay, how do they claim? What are the supporting documents they have submitted? And she asked, in fact, you know, the people, industry, that please provide the document in support of whatever the statement which you are making. And you will be surprised, they were floored. She introduced, in fact, you know, in US, ban on use of the terminology that this kills germs. She said that until unless you prove it quantitatively, it is just not acceptable. In India, great, we sir, permitted, great. In India, we permitted until recent. Till this corona issue came up, hats off to our Ministry of Health. He said that you wash your hands with a soap. They don't call it as a sanitizing soap. No. They know it pretty well. That what are all the liquid soaps available in the market, they are all hoax. And the US FDA commissioner, she proved that these are no better than the ordinary soap. So similar kind of, based on this aspect, even the Indian health minister also is taken up, and you will find that people, he has introduced a terminology, you wash your hand with soap. He does not say that sanitizing agent first. After that, yes, you sanitize. And for that sanitization purpose, you require to have not less than 70% of alcohol, ethanol, mind you, to be effective. Even in industry, in fact, you know, for sanitizing some of the equipment, we do use 70% of isopropanol. That also works very well. So any one of these two. In fact, in the hospitals, you will find that after the operation, you know, the doctor will recommend use of sanitizing agent. And if you see the label claim of those items, you will find that they contain either 70% alcohol or 70% of isopropanol. So this is the reality.
Sir, thank you very much for this. एक छोटा सा क्वेश्चन सर इससे निकलता है. please, अभी मार्केट में सर वेजिटेबल स्पेशली सर पैक्ड फूड्स तो अलग है, पैक्ड जो है पैक्ड मटेरियल्स हैं उसको तो सैनिटाइज किया जा सकता है. वेजिटेबल्स के लिए बहुत अलग अलग तरह की भ्रांति है. कहते हैं नमक के पानी में कर लो, गर्म पानी में कर लो, बेकिंग सोडा में कर लो. अभी वो हाइपोक्लोराइड का सोल्यूशन आ रहा है 5% या 10%. तो आपके हिसाब से बीइंग एन अथॉरिटी, व्हाट विल यू रिकमेंड सर?
आई विल सजेस्ट, यू नो, देयर इज अ वन इक्विपमेंट व्हिच इज मार्केटेड व्हिच प्रोवाइड्स द ओजोनाइज्ड वाटर. द वाटर कंटेन्स ओजोन. ओजोन इज अ डैम गुड एंटीऑक्सीडेंट. And it will kill the germs or any external material which is attached to the drug, which is attached to the any food article, or for that purpose any one of the vegetable or fruits. It works very well, ozonization, because the ozonization is also used, that is essentially the ozone. It is also used in a pharmaceutical industry, in an area which is aseptic area, and the area specially, in fact, you know, which is manufacturing sterile product with a virtually, when they want a zero bacterium kind of a concept, zero contamination, at that time the area is decontaminated using the ozone. And it works extremely good. I have worked with that. I had opportunity, in fact, you know, to set up the first facility of this kind in the country. And it works very well.
But is it marketable and available in the market? Or hai to kis brand se hai, sir?
Yes. Ozonization equipment is also marketed. I just forget the brand name. There is a product available which they claim that it provides you ozone.
Okay.
All that you require to do is that put that one in the water, and I mean, you allow the water to have the ozonize, and then subsequent to that you can put your vegetables as well as any other fruits. Similarly, if you do not have the ozonization, you can as well use the hypochlorite.
Yes, sir.
Sodium hypochlorite, which is available, in the concentration of about 2 to 5 ppm, it will work very well. It will work very well. In industry, we do use sodium hypochlorite in the lower concentration of the material for sanitizing. You know, it liberates the chlorine as a nascent chlorine, and the nascent chlorine goes off. The moment it has sanitized the area, you will find that the chlorine will go off into the atmosphere. Similarly, if you get ozone also, it will work very well. I can tell you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Sir. Thank you very much for clarifying the doubts. Satish, you can continue.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for giving the information about this ozonization process, sir. I too have got one instrument, sir, at home used for that purpose.
Used for the?
I too have got one product at my home of this kind, ozonizer.
Okay, very nice. Very nice. काम करो राक्षस को बता दो कि आपके पास है
सतीश कौन सा है ये
बिल्कुल
सतीश यू कैन शेयर आप शेयर कर सकते हैं सबके साथ
Sir, exactly the company name I am not able to recall, but sir, definitely I will share with everybody after some time. I have got sir at my home.
But okay, very good.
Name sir.
आप अपने ग्रुप के साथ सबके साथ इसको शेयर करिएगा.
It is being advertised by one of the leading, in fact, you know, actress. I just forget her name.
Even to sanitize the area, sir, where we keep our shoes and all the things, so we can also spray the air of that product so that it will be sanitized there also.
Yes, I agree with you. In fact, you know, the ozonization is the best one because ozone as a molecule, you know it better than me, it's a very unstable. It will oxidize, yes. In fact, you know, whatever it comes in contact with, and thereby yes. gets converted into the oxygen, and it will go off. Nothing leaving behind onto the product. Whereas in case of a hypochlorite, you can use a hypochlorite also in a low concentration of about 2 to 2 ppm. It will also work very well. But only
Thank
thing
you,
is that while preparing hypochlorite solution, you will have to be very carefully done. Where you have to be very careful while diluting this sodium hypochlorite, which is generally about say 4%. You have to dilute it in a water and then protect yourself and then make sure that the chlorine which is liberated over that you do not inhale.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much.
Thank you. My pleasure.
One question is from a student, sir. He want to ask what type of skills we build according to industry requirement after this pandemic.
Very good question. I must appreciate. I appreciate the student. You know.
Thank you, sir.
See, what is very
important. Pavan Khatri.
let me just tell you one thing.
Yes, sir.
And you teachers will agree with me. We need to significantly improve the knowledge of microbiology.
Yes, sir.
In academia. Today, in fact, you know, because I do interview the number of candidates, in fact, you know, for industries, even today. And I notice that the basic knowledge of microbiology is concerned. It is conspicuous by its absence. They have no idea. Because in the academic institutions, we do not give importance to what is given in the pharmacopoeia. I am telling you that in my time when I was a student, I am talking of 1963, it was compulsory for us. I studied at Sagar University. It was compulsory for us that every day we had to carry Indian Pharmacopoeia, our own personal copy, to the college. One day, you will surprise, I forgot my Indian Pharmacopoeia copy, book. to be taken to the college. So my professor Harkishan Singh, I don't know whether you have heard of him.
Sir, yes, sir. I have heard. Even sir, we have gone through the books written by him, sir.
He was my teacher.
Yes, sir.
And I had excellent
chemistry books are available, sir. Especially. Yeah, yeah.
Yes, so sir. He came. He was taking over practicals, and he came to my table and asked me, Shrotriya, please tell, where is your pharmacopoeia? So regretfully, I just told him. I said, sir, I am sorry. Today I have forgotten. It is in the hostel. Can you imagine? He told me, we were only 9 students in my batch, B Pharm, first year. He told me, okay, Shrotriya, do one thing. Go and bring it from the hostel. Up the hill, 1.5 kilometer, down the hill, 1.5 kilometer, in a scorching sun, I had to go bring the Indian pharmacopoeia, showed it to Professor Harkishan Singh, and then he allowed me to continue with your practical. Today you will find that the students, even in the library students, they do not go to look at the pharmacopoeia. I was a member in the pharmacopoeia commission, and I was the chairman for the injectable. And I can tell you one thing, I give a lot of importance to the Indian pharmacopoeia, particularly Indian pharmacopoeia. Internationally, if you ask my opinion, I will say USP is the best. It's better than even USP, better than even Indian pharmacopoeia. Way back to 2009, we entered into an agreement with European pharmacopoeia, British pharmacopoeia, as well as the USP, that whatever each one of us would like to take from the each one of these pharmacopoeia, we can adopt and we can take it. We used to take, and so was the case, as I mentioned earlier, anti-HIV drug, the first time in the world, yes, the monographs appeared in Indian pharmacopoeia. And yes, USP requested, they did not have referred to us, but they requested and said that, yes, we would like to. And we said, okay, please go ahead. So
thank you, sir.
This is the one is the Indian pharmacopoeia. Another one is, make it compulsory in your college. Nowadays, I know that the Indian pharmacopoeia has become very expensive. I have already requested, in fact, the Indian pharmacopoeia commission, as well as pharmacopoeia laboratory, director of the pharmacopoeia laboratory, that you must come out with a revised price, or for that purpose, the concessional rate for students. But it has not taken place. But that's the reality. So what you can do is that you should keep in the laboratory, one set of the relevant volume for the practical which they are going to carry out in the laboratory. Definitely. Keep the relevant pharmacopoeia. And for that purpose, otherwise, what you can do is that you can take a photocopy out of that, and in fact, carry out the lamination of it, and keep those things depending on the type of practical which you have, and let the students refer that. They must have a habit of referring pharmacopoeia. You will surprise. I have got my in my personal library, I have got my pharmacopoeia copy. Not only this, but even the Indian Ayurvedic pharmacopoeia also I have got in my personal library.
Very nice to read.
And
very
I do nice. Read, even today I read. There is another thing which I have. I think I don't know whether I have mentioned about it. One of my students, she was working for PhD. She came to me and told me that, sir, whether can you please suggest me a project for my PhD program? Hello.
Yes, sir.
Can you hear me? Yeah.
Thank you, sir.
I said, yes, I can. I will suggest you. And you will surprise, I was studying Sushrut Sanhita. You will surprise that in Sushrut time also, malaria exists. Malaria was there.
Yes.
based on that my study, I worked out a project for the student. And I told her, I said, okay, this is going to be your project. So she made a presentation, total presentation, and went to the experts, you know, presentation to the experts. The experts committee asked her that, you have made a mention of a Sushrut Sanhita. So who suggested you, number one, and who has given you this particular project? She told my name. And the experts who were present over there, they said, okay, we have no more questions. You go by what Dr. Kshatriya has suggested you and do that. Even today, I read, I'm telling you.
Sure, sir.
I read.
Definitely, we will make it happen.
I believe in continuing education. It is a must. I am very, very restless person. And I made a mention of the Dr. Vanzil, you know, who has come out with the guideline.
Yes, sir.
I know Dr. Vanzil very well. Since he had inspected me number of times in number of companies and approved. And I can tell you one thing, you know, that it is Vanzil, I really appreciate the way he has written the guidelines. How to open up, you know, the pharmaceutical industry. What do you need to do? I have just briefly covered. It is almost about 8 to 9 pages document.
Yes, sir.
I think it will do a lot of good to you people, for the students, for the teachers also. You need to get into these aspects. And I'll be very happy and help you and support you. Any information which you require for even for your day-to-day practicals, even for undergraduate level, even for the postgraduate level, or even for a doctorate level. I'll be very glad to do it.
Thank you very much, sir. Definitely, sir. Definitely, we will approach you. My second question is, sir, it is from my side. In today's newspaper, I read that America has stopped funding to WHO, sir. And I think, sir, it is also correlated to China. So how it is going to affect our Indian pharmaceutical market, sir?
Question, it's a good question. I'll tell you why, you know, the, about 80% of the funding which WHO receives,
yes, sir,
that is from US. When the WHO top head, after the corona was broke out in China, he went to China. He has done a lot of favor to China for not disclosing it for quite some time. And the world got to know about it, that this gentleman was financed by China to become, in fact, you know, WHO top man. He was in the Ethiopia, he was the health minister of Ethiopia. And from there, he was taken up by China because China had helped him even in Ethiopia financially. And subsequent to that, when he went to WHO, the WHO also financing was done by China. As a result of it, to reward China, the WHO had, when he went immediately after the corona broke out in China, Wuhan, he arrived at an understanding with the Chinese top bosses. And it was not disclosed for quite some time. That's the reason the world got to know of it. And in fact, you know, the BBC had given the news item of this. And I had commented on that BBC news, and I sent it to them. They came back with my comments and said that we have referred your comments to our editor. I said, fine, I have no problem. Whatever your editor says, you can go ahead with. They referred the matter. After a few days, they came back to me and said, No, the editor has accepted. And I had used a very, very strong language that the head of WHO should be kicked out for spreading this corona infection to the whole world. Today, you know what is the level. It is worse than the Third World War.
Yes, sir.
It is worse than Third World War. So it is, let us accept it as a reality. I think, you know, it is a matter of WHO will not be able to survive without funding of US. And I will not be surprised if he is kicked out. So far as the WHO coordinating chairman is concerned, the WHO carried out a secret ballot, as I mentioned.
Yes, sir.
194 countries, they voted in favor of Indian health minister. And he very recently, he chaired the session.
Sir. Yes.
So that is a reality. In fact, you know, the international recognition is coming to India. And you take it from me, if herbals are concerned, Ayurvedic products are concerned, if we go in a systematic manner, quantify, in fact, you know, the active constituent present over there, establish the stringent quality standards, and prepare the product, evaluate it for its repeat performance and assurance, rest assured, Ayurvedic product will zoom up in the world market. I can tell you that. Because in the Western world is concerned, I travel extensively. I do interact with the people. Western world has already now fed up with the chemical substances, chemical drugs. Let's accept it. The adverse drug reactions which are there. No doctor will tell you, let me tell you honestly. In our country, I remember almost about 20 years back, the drug controller general then, he had introduced a system that when he allows you to introduce a new drug, in that case, there is something called as a patient information leaflet. It used to be, it was a compulsory one in 1970s and early. All Western countries, Western world people, Western manufacturers, they used to market their product in India with a PIL. That's called PIL, patient information leaflet, and which provides all the details, including adverse drug reaction. In India also, they had introduced for a while granting the permission for the new drug. But subsequent to that, it has disappeared. Why? Because it costs money. And under the DPCO, the price control is very, very heavy so far as the drug industry is concerned. In fact, I am not in favor of the ruthless price control that the government imposes on the drug and pharmaceutical industry. No. How do you expect? Where will the industry get money to plow back in the research? Where is the research activity then? So you are throttling, as a matter of fact, so far as the finances are concerned. Whatever the meager financial, I would say, the consideration which they have given, in terms of the budget or in terms of the income tax to the companies, these are peanuts, let me tell you. I have worked in the pharma industry in various categories, right up to the top level. And I know that how it works. It cannot be done the way it is being done today.
Thank you, sir. Sir, there was also a question, but probably I think you have replied to that question already, that a student wanted to ask that what will be the status of Ayurveda after 5 to 10 years, but in your talk, you were answering the question. So even for Ayurvedic products, you talked and you have spoken about that.
Yeah, I will add one more sentence for that. It can have a phenomenal, I would say, the opportunity, provided it has got an established standard, even for the impurities, metallic impurities especially, active component, quantification of active components, and reassurance in terms of the therapeutic value after conducting the clinical trials, not on the paper, in real sense.
Yes.
There is no doubt about it. Like, gone are the days when somebody will say, you know, that my grandfather was using Chyawanprash, so my grandchildren should use the Chyawanprash. It is all nonsense and hoax. People advertise on TV also that it contains vitamin C. What is the minuscule quantity of vitamin C present in the amla? What is the concentration? It is all nonsense. In India, because we have got a democracy, nobody questions. But given a chance to me, I will tear apart, in fact, such advertisers as well as companies, as well as the promoters. They are cheating public.
Yes, sir.
The product, in the Ayurvedic product, I can tell you one thing. Some of the Ayurvedic products, they are damn good products.
Thank you, sir.
They are very good products, provided you provide with the assurance of a therapeutic value. Because the Western world wants to shift now from chemical substances, that is a drug, allopathic drug, to Ayurvedic. They want to shift, provided India can provide answer to that, what I told you. And I do contemplate that with the present government over there, the clinical trials they are conducting with the three drugs, Tulsi, Ashwagandha, and Giloy. If they come out successfully, these are the modern approach in the clinical trials. First time in the history in India, carried out by any government agency. They are doing it, and the moment they will come out with the answer, if it found satisfactory, I can rest assure you, these products will have a phenomenal market. And so along with that, even the other Ayurvedic product also will have excellent opportunity. I will strongly suggest, as a matter of fact, you know, teachers in academic institution to support, in fact, you know, Ayurvedic or a herbal standardization in terms of the modern pharmaceutical requirements.
Sure.
Assured quality.
Yes, sir.
Not hit and run away.
Yes, sir. Definitely, sir. Whatever suggestions you have given, I would start practicing those literally. I mean, in this upcoming session, I will introduce all those things in my institution.
No, definitely. I'll be too glad. I'm, you know, some of the things which I have given, I have written a book. The book is under publication now. I have given, the title of the book is What Went Wrong?
Pharmaceutical. Very nice, sir.
What went wrong? Pharmaceutical technology case studies. There are no books, there are no literature available on this subject. And these are based on the regulatory investigations. I have faced numerous inspections. And based on the numerous inspection, whatever the complaint which we received, how did we investigate? How do you require to have a documentation? What do you require to do? How do you create, in fact, you know, the complaint in your laboratory? How do you take, in fact, you know, the CAPA, that is corrective action, preventive action? And how do you close the complaint? I have also provided in the book, in fact, you know, the format for registering the complaint, what all information that you require. In the book, I have given that. I have also given one last part of the book. How do you integrate regulatory with the other subjects of pharmaceutical sciences? How do we integrate? Can we? As of today, the regulatory is concerned, it is considered as an isolation. We do not bother. But this is the reality. we must know how to integrate it. And I have given in that, I have covered this aspect also in the book, the last part of the book.
Thank you, sir. Hopefully
the book should be out in the month of June, next coming month.
Definitely. Sir, one more question was there. India is a very huge supplier of generic medicinal products also,
yes.
To other countries. So now, sir, in this situation, when our Prime Minister has also asked people to set up the things in India, and will the generic market in India is going to rise in upcoming session?
I do contend that yes, there is no doubt about it. But let me caution you.
Yes, sir.
The way mushroom growth of a generic manufacturer, it is not advisable.
Yes, sir.
Generic products available in the market must have, say, when you go to US and if you want to introduce your product as a generic product, yeah, by all means you can do that, but you have to prove that your product is bioequivalent to that of the innovator, the first company which introduced the drug. Your product has to be compared with that of the innovator, and if it is found satisfactory in terms of the BAB studies, then only that particular product. It must have the pharmaceutical equivalence. It must be bioequivalence also to the innovator product. And then, yes, you can introduce. But in our country, sorry to say, but that's a reality. All the generic products which are available, no bioavailability studies, and hardly few companies they might have done. They have just come out with a generic name. There is no assurance that the therapeutic availability of the drug and the bioequivalence of the generic product with that of the innovator product, it is assured, it is there. No, it's a big question. So what I prefer, if you ask me, if I go for any generic product, I will go for a generic product of a well-known brand, well-known company, and preferably the multinational or the giant organization of the country. I will not buy the product of any Tom, Dick and Harry company, where there is a questionability in terms of therapeutic activity, therapeutic equivalence, as well as the quality. And as well as the Ayurvedic products are concerned, I will think 10 times before buying anybody's product. Let me tell you, there are very good products also available. Ayurvedic preparations, there are very good products. I'm tempted to give you one more example. There is one product called Saraswata Rist, marketed by, I just forget the name. I'll just tell you the name of the company. And you know, my father-in-law, he was Ayurveda Acharya. So when I used to visit him,
great, sir, great.
At that time, he used to discuss with me a lot. And he used to tell me that you must be having a lot of mental work, you know. So he advised me one product, a product called Saraswata Rist. He told me that you buy this Saraswata Rist and take it every day at bedtime, just 2 teaspoonful. I must tell you, it's a damn good product. It's a damn good Saraswata Rist. It has got a mental, it contains, I'm telling you that also, it contains Brahmi. And Sitapushpi also. Both of them, they have got a damn good therapeutic value on the brain. And it calms down. So I'm telling you, you know, that there are products There are very good. There are Brahmi, there is a Brahmi syrup also. All Brahmi syrups marketed by every company is not good. There are one or two companies whose products are extremely good.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah, please.
Yes, sir. One more question is that what will be the direct challenges and opportunity for the pharmacy students, sir, especially in
Very good question. Whether this question has come from pharmacy student or you are asking for them?
Sir, one of the students asked this question, sir.
Very good.
Thank you, sir.
Opportunity, I will tell you one thing. With the corona coming in, there can be a tremendous opportunity because India has been recognized as a pharmacy of the world.
Yes, sir.
When India is recognized as a pharmacy of the world, you can imagine what will be the opportunity. But I have made a mention of some of the things which we really require to relook at. If we are complacent with what we have, what we are, and what we have, it won't work. I had a talk with, in fact, you know, the president of Pharmacy Council of India. You know, I'm very, very vocal in terms of what I don't accept, and I will tell point blank. I spoke to him and I told him, and I have also categorically said that what we really require to make a change, we need a change. Let me tell you just one example which comes to my mind and which I covered here. That is the subject of pharmaceutical engineering. In the pharmaceutical engineering, what we teach has a nonsense value. It has no value in pharma industry, let me tell you. It has no value. What we really require is pharmaceutical process-wise, the machinery, the knowledge of machinery, the limitation of the machinery, criticality of the machinery, and how this machinery can help in standardization of the process. These are the things which we require.
Yes.
You know, for NMIMS University, I had designed a course, M.Pharm in Pharmaceutical Engineering. That was with this objective. The course was passed by the Academic Council. It was accepted by the university. But unfortunate part was that students have no idea. So that is why the course could not come up. Another course which I designed and it was implemented, that was on the drug development and regulatory science. How do you write from the development of the drug up to the marketing of the drug and post-marketing even? How do you link up, in fact, you know, the regulatory compliance to the regulatory requirements? This was the course. 10 students we had. All the 10 students, they are very well placed in the pharma industry today. There was one more subject, one more course which I had designed for the university. And that was an industrial pharmacy, not the conventional industrial pharmacy, with specific objective. I used to monitor M.Pharm research as well as the PhD research scholars. They used to come to me, interact with me, and I used to correct them, help them, and guide them out. And they used to work. Number of, it will go in terms of at